visible and screen is also visible, right?
Yes, sir. So visible.
Okay. One second, sir. Friends, good afternoon to everyone. Sir, voice கேக்குதில்லையா?
ஆ ஓகே வாய்ஸ் கேக்குது சார். ஓகே சார்.
ஓகே சார்.
குட் ஆஃப்டர்நூன் சார்.
ஓகே. So friends, today we are going to discuss, I hope in our first session we have discussed about the introduction of the subject as well as what is maintenance and why it is required. And what is repair, what is rehabilitation, what is the difference between these two terminology, and when you have to go for repair and when you have to go for rehabilitation, and what is the value addition by the rehabilitation term, what is the value addition by the term repair, that we have all seen. Sir, என்னுடைய மொபைல் அதில் கேட்க மாட்டேங்க என் வாய்ஸ். நான் வேணால் டிஸ்கனெக்ட் பண்ணிட்டு திருப்பி வருவா.
மொபைல் நீங்கள் மியூட் பண்ணியிருப்பீங்க சார்.
அப்படியா? ஒன் செகண்ட் சார், ஒரே ஒரு செகண்ட். நான் டிஸ்கனெக்ட் பண்ணி திருப்பி ஜாயின், ஏன்னா என்னோடய ப்ரெசன்டேஷன் கரெக்டாக வருதா இல்லையான்னு பார்க்குறதுக்காக நான் அதுலேயும் ஜாயின் பண்ணுறேன். ஓ ஜஸ்ட் அ மொமெண்ட். ஹலோ. ஆ யெஸ் சார். ஸோ ஃப்ரெண்ட்ஸ், I have shared some few documents and notes for your references so that the notes has been prepared with the objective of making the subject to feel more easier, and at the same time when you come out of your course, suppose if you get an opportunity to work under the repair and rehabilitation field, it may be of any concrete structure, it may be of building or a bridge, so if whatever we discuss under this subject, I feel very strongly that this details will certainly play a vital role for yourself when you go to the role of a site in charge or a project in charge or a quality control engineer, and even the checking of the reinforcement detailings, and even when you get an opportunity to assess the problem. Okay, so now today we are going to move forward further under this repair and rehabilitation of structure. Friends, in civil engineering, this we used to study about tension, compression, shearing, torsion, bending, buckling. So these are all the various forces that the object is subjected to. It may be of slab, or it may be of a beam, or it may be of column. So somehow this combination will play a vital role due to the dead load as well as due to the live load. The maximum load which the body will be subjected to will be of dead load, self weight, because throughout the design service life period it has to withstand its own weight. That is why it is always essential whenever you are subjected to design a residential building, keeping in view of our future development. Probably by this planned year, you may be subjected to design for only ground floor. The owner maybe, or the client maybe, will be subjected to go for a construction of only ground floor. They won't have the intent of to go for a immediately ground floor plus 2 floor. But in nearby future, your client or owner may go for further developments. So therefore, for further developments, keeping in view of the further development, once again, the residential building cannot be redesigned for the additional dead load that is going to come. Even though your client is going to, or your owner is going to, subjected to go for only a ground floor construction, that doesn't mean that you have to consider only the dead load of only ground floor components. In nearby future, in case if they go for other additional one floor or two floors, that future load also should be considered into your design assumption. Otherwise, the additional dead load, your components, designed components may not be viable to take care of it. When any component is not viable to take care of its own dead load, then the live load, obviously it will fail. Therefore, then again, you have to go for jacketing. Jacketing is a process where you have to increase the geometry of the section by recasting with additional reinforcement, and the reinforcement has to be connected properly with the old reinforcement detailing because for the load transfer. That is a very costly method. So, but that is always advisable. Even when you planned after this completion of your degree, if you are going to start your own design concern, then you should be in a position to take care of your future loads, the future establishments, and accordingly you have to design your component. You may say, sir, my client is having a financial viability to only go for constructing this ground floor, but if I go for considering the additional dead loads, other two floors, then the design of the requirement of area of steel will become more. Then it will have an additional cost also, sir. That will increase my client's additional the financial burden. My dear friends, if you feel like that, but you think of if after 2 years or 3 years or 5 years, he wants to go for additional one floor or two floors, then the foundation or column will not able to take it. Then in such case, you have to re-establish everything and you have to go for additional column, additional footings, additional beams. That is more and more costlier, and it will have, because in the limited availability of land, why the multi-story flats become very famous, because within the availability of land constraint what we are facing, you are able to construct more number of houses and you are able to give more living areas for more number of people in a within a confined land location. Okay, so my dear friends, when your object, a beam or a column or a slab, are subjected to under this type of combination of all this compression, tension, shear, bending, buckling, it will always subjected to some distress. Now, whether that distress your designed component is able to resist and it will not undergo the pattern of with the development of crack or with the due to the external factor of environmental impact, it may not, it should not undergo deteriorations due to weathering, environmental effect, and so on. So in such cases, how we are going to handle the situation? The design life period of the your structure is also to be ensured, and your client living, the stability or the integrity of the building has to be ensured, and the safety of your client livingness inside the structure should also be ensured. So in that such a type of critical situation, if a client approaches you to go for, sir, if a client comes to you, sir, this is the problem I am seeing in my house, can you please give me the remedial measure? You should not immediately say, sir, sorry, in my papers I have not studied to deal with the crack, how to overcome the crack, how to overcome the corrosion effect, how to overcome the leaching effect, how to overcome that any sort of distresses. So better you dismantle and reconstruct. Then the client will never return back. Hey, what happened? This engineer is simply saying, I'm just gone for a remedial measure. Yeah, for immediately saying is you have to dismantle. It is something like going to a doctor for a small wound or some pain. Your doctor says, if the doctor says to the patient, your organ has to be removed, your hand has to be removed, your palm has to be removed, your leg has to be removed, your ear has to, if you're going with a ear pain, if the doctor says your ears has to be removed, if you're going with eye pain, if a doctor says your eyes has to be removed, then it will be a very difficult situation for the patient to understand and come back. And he will say that the doctor is not good. This engineer, if you go to this engineer, he will always say demolish and reconstruct. That should not be the case for you when you handle the situation, when the concrete structures are undergone some sorts of distresses. So it is your responsibility to understand why the distress happened, what is the root cause of the distress, what is the source of the distress, and you should be very in a comfortable position to define what type of distress. Your client may say, your customer say, sir, I have seen the paint are getting peeled off. Sir, I am undergoing wetness on my wall. I am undergoing the wetness on the slab, water logging. And some of the cracks are seen on the beams or columns or even in the wall. Now only Graha Pravesham has completed. Within a few months, I am seeing this problem. So those situation may arise and the customer will approach you. Even in your own living areas, you may see such type of problems. So you should be in a comfortable position to define the problem, the root cause of the problem, source of the problem, then accordingly you have to treat. That is the purpose of now today we are going to see how you will define a problem. When you are able to define a problem, it will be very easy to define the solution. Okay. Now, so as we have seen in our last class, even though you are defined, you have implemented remedial measure, the recurrence of the problem, your focus, when you are involved in the activity of repair and rehabilitation, now the participants are nearly 21 participants, including me, it is 22. If these 21 participants want to ensure that the recurrence of problem has to be minimized or has to be cut off completely, then the term quality assurance scheme or quality assurance plan, which is going to help you, is going to bind your rehabilitation or repair methodology to sustain for the defined design period. Therefore, it is always required, the term quality, I always insist that the term quality is not only common for the site people, site implementation team, it is the term common for all civil engineers. It has to start from your drawing room. From the designer, it has to start. You should be in a comfortable position to deliver a qualitative detailing. My dear friends, in the last session, I said, please, for detailing, some failures are happening because of the poor detailing part. Any problem that arises in a structure, the first check will be only of design. Check whether the design is in right. The next, only the site check, whether the quality of material is good, whether the strength is being attained. So the first question will be asked to the designers. So you should be in a well defined, you should be in a very comfortable position to define each and every parameter. The structure that this 21 participant going to deliver has to behave as per your assumption. The your structure is your baby. Your baby has to behave as per your assumption. If it behaves something differently, then you have made something wrong in the assumption, or you have missed some parameters in the initial detailing or design part. So you should be very comfortable with the code which you are dealing with. If you are dealing with repair and rehabilitation, there is a beautiful code called IRC SP40, Guidelines for Repair, Strengthening, Rehabilitation of the Structures. My dear friends, concrete is a concrete. If the concrete is going to be used in a building, it is going to have a different geometrical shape. It is going to have a different load parameters. But concrete is a concrete. M15, M20, M25 and so on will always behave in the same fashion in both building as well as in bridge. The principle cannot be changed. No one can change the principle. The column which is going to behave like a buckling in the building will the same effect. Buckling term only will be in the bridges. The pier. Here you are giving the name as pier. Pier also will undergo the same principle buckling effect. The beams. Here we call it as a pier cap or the long girders. So all will be subject to flexure, as how you are defining the beam as a flexure member in the residential buildings. The same way here also it will subject to flexure. Same shear. Shear will be very strong in support location. Bending moment will be very strong in the mid portion, in a simply supported. The same principle or behavior only will happen in a very simply supported bridges which you are seeing outside your college campus, that is in the National Highways. So therefore, the principles are quite same. After this session, I will be sharing the code in our WhatsApp group IRC SP40, and even I will share to your professor, Vijay Vignesh. So he will be sharing to you. Please refer the code, refer IS 456. In this presentation, I have just tried my best to bring the sweetness of some tables in our today's discussion. So a quality assurance scheme is a management scheme which increases confidence. My dear friends, you have to create your confidence to the customers, and more importantly, you have to create a confidence of yourself. Your friends will not help you when you go out of your campus. You have to act independently. As an external faculty member, I am just dealing this paper, how not focusing on how you're going to deal this in the exam point of view. I am dealing this paper with yourself, how you're going to deal when you come out of your degree. I am trying my best to develop the skill, because the industry doesn't look for the toppers, marks, top mark scorers. The industry is looking for the skill developed engineers. How skilled enough you are in understanding the basics of civil engineering. How skilled enough to deal with the concrete member when he's subjected to crack. How skilled enough you are reinforcement has undergone corrosion effect to overcome. How skilled enough to deal with this? How skilled enough you are going to deal with the detailing part? When your owner has scheduled you to look into a concreting of today, a slab, how skilled enough, how much skill you have developed to deal independently the concreting of a slab? What are the checkpoints? So therefore, my focus in dealing this paper is to add value to your skill level. Everybody is skilled enough, provided you utilize the opportunity that comes to you and shine yourself. So right hand side, I tried my best to put on the quality assurance scheme. So it outlines the commitments, policies, designated responsibilities and requirement of the owner. My dear friends, the owner at the student stage is the owner is your paper evaluator is the owner. You have to deliver your answers to the satisfaction of the evaluator, paper evaluator, or to the satisfaction of the university question paper. Whereas when you come out, your owner is your customer is your owner. So you have to deliver all the detailings to the satisfaction of your customers. If you are able to, if you want to retain your customer to come back repeatedly with more references, you have to create a confidence. You have to fulfill the commitments. And you have to fulfill the designated responsibilities. So therefore, you should deliver a very qualitative detailing, so design part, drawing part, and the methodology part also. So when you want to deliver all this in a qualitatively, you should be very comfortable in understanding the problem. That's why in the left hand side, I tried my best to put on the causes of deterioration. Number one, design and construction problem, environmental effect, usage of poor quality material, quality of supervision. So these are the few things which may be the causes for the deterioration. And now the deterioration due to corrosion. My dear friend, today most of the problems are happening because of the corrosion, because in a hurry-burry they are putting the concreting. Therefore, in the site people, their focus is only to complete concreting of today's slab, means they have to complete it. Today, completing the concreting of beam and column means they have to complete it. The focus is completion and go for opening the structure. That's it. They want to complete it with the scheduled time. But my dear friends, there should not be any lagness in the quality of execution. You got my point? So when you are dealing with a corrosion, the only way point is you have to go for chip off all the loose materials and you have to repair it properly. Otherwise, the recurrence of problem will occur. Now, this slide deals with the survey revealed that construction defects could be grouped into four classes. Number one, deficiencies in the control of concrete materials, batching and mixing. My dear friends, before the concreting, you plan first to understand how much time is going to take place from the batching plan that is going to reach your place of concreting time. Your batching, your RMC truck should not stand for hours before it pours the material into the desired location, planned location. And to avoid the hardness of concrete or the curing of concrete, at the last moment also, they used to add some chemicals so that it will be in the designed proportion and the workability can be maintained. But all these small errors make you the problem on the long term, not immediately. Therefore, you should plan in a very pakka way such that the quality is assured. Even you can plan as a mock-up test. What is the time travel? If you are planning to concrete in a busy scheduled peak hour time in the metro city or urban area, what is the time duration from the batching plant to your site? Then what are all the things, steps to be taken up before the RMC plant comes? How the site preparation? Then when the RMC truck comes, what are all the roles and responsibilities of each and every team members? How they have to act and how they are, the truck has to be received and how it has to be stationed and how it has to be poured. Everything, even you can go for a mock-up. You got it, my friends? Then inadequate preparation before concreting. My dear friends, all the materials has to undergo laboratory test. Even our code says you have to go for potable water for concreting. The materials also undergo some chemical test, abrasion test. sand, aggregates, then the water has to be undergone a chemical test. Because if the water is salty water, sometimes after concreting, automatically your steel will get, even though you are maintained a good cover, you have provided painting also, external painting also, but still, since the concrete is not prepared properly with the potable water, then it will cause injury to the structural steel and structural concrete internally. And you will see only the distress when it develops cracks or spanning. Then the repairing of those things are very, very costly, and it has to be in a very skilled way you have to do it. Then inadequacy of placing and subsequent treatment, faults of construction planning and procedure. So everything has to be ensured before concreting comes. Next, causes of design faults. So due to misinterpretation, client's needs, lack of good communication. My dear friends, what can anyone, the participants, can say, what is the language of civil engineers? Friends, can anyone say?
Drawing, sir.
Friends, please introduce yourself.
Richin, sir.
Sir, good name?
Richin, sir. R-I-C-H-I-N.
Yeah, Mr. Richin, please. Please tell me, sir. Tell me, sir.
The drawing of the buildings.
Correct. Drawing is the language of civil engineers. The communication with the drawing room or a design office and the site is through drawings. That is why I always insist to go for a qualitative design assumption, quality in detailing, quality in drawing deliverable. You have to develop more cross sections. You should not go for a limited cross section, limited detailing, considering that the site people will be having experience of 10 years, 15 years, 30 years. Even though they may have several years of experience, the mistake, whatever they do, they will be doing for 10 years, 15 years without knowing that they are doing mistakes, errors. So please develop the habit of rough sketches. If you get the one side back sheets, develop more plans, more cross section, free hand sketches. Then you sit in the AutoCAD, then AutoCAD is only a tool to come up to develop the details in a scale, to the scale. But rough sketches are from your brain. My dear friends, you are the brain of repair and rehabilitation. You are the brain of civil engineers. Whatever you are thinking, that is going to be delivered in form of drawing. So rough sketches, develop the habit of creation. You have to be in expertise in deliverables through drawings. For anything, everything, you have to develop their sketches. Don't worry that it should be in scale, nevertheless. But the concept of civil engineering is only, the concept of civil engineering can only be dealt through drawings. Please keep in your mind, my dear friend. The next, causes of faults in construction. Misinterpretation of design drawings or specifications. Lack of effective communication with suppliers and subcontractors. You may be thinking something that your shuttering will be like this. They will put the additional shutters in the horizontal, in the vertical. And you may think that there is no curvature. But actual outside, there may be a curvature. In your design, the curvature may not be taken into picture. So there should be an effective communication between yourself. And you may be thinking some assumption, and accordingly you develop the material what is required. But that assumption may not reach to the supplier. Then what will happen? He will assume something. Okay, this type of I did for the last client also, I delivered same thing. Okay, I think this may be like this only. Then he will be delivering something. It will not be meet your requirement. Then you have to return it back. Or sometimes you may be compromised. My dear friends, you can have a compromise in anything, not in the deliverables. You cannot have a compromise, that word, in your answer sheet at the student's face. The same way, when you come out and when you become a skilled engineer, you cannot use the word compromise in your drawing sheet, because the term, once you go bend yourself for the word compromise, then you have to compromise everything: strength, durability, serviceability, and even the safety. Don't compromise on the work, on the deliverables. Be very strong like a steel. Then inefficient coordination, inadequate on-site supervision, poor workmanship. You are dumb, my dear friends. If you are having the dream of to become a design engineer, you should develop the skill of AutoCAD, the drawings. Your the CAD person is only going to do what you are giving in the rough sketch. So you should develop a rough sketch, and even you should know the skill of AutoCAD person. Then only you can drive them. My dear friends, you should be in the driver's seat. All the participants, now it becomes 17 participants, 17 members should be in the driver's seat to get a very quality work. Otherwise, if you are driven, then you cannot get a good quality product. Now, what is causes of rent? My dear friends, I always say, don't get panic when you see a crack. This bridge is opened just 1 month back, ma, it got cracked. This building is got grab problem only 6 months back, or even 3 months back, or 1 month. Suddenly crack has appeared. My dear friends, concrete will always subject to crack only. You are the engineer who is going to define whether it is structural or non-structural. For both structural and non-structural, you have a very well-defined treatment. So no need to worry, or no need to get panic on seeing the cracks. It may be of small thermal cracks. Nevertheless, because of variation in the temperature, the cracks may occur. Don't worry. Be happy. Am I right, Mr. Richan?
I could say so, sir.
Don't worry. For everything, my dear friends, if you don't have a problem, the solution will not be available. The principle of the company from where I'm coming is, we are working with the objective of come with a problem and go with the bags of solution. In that concept, we are doing our job, day-to-day job. You got my friends? So don't get panic on seeing the problem. Be happy that you are get an opportunity to deliver some different solution. Okay, so whenever you come across a crack, first you have to define what type of crack, what is the root cause of the crack, what is the pattern of the crack, what is the duration of the crack period, and so as I explained in my class, first you have to define the width and depth of the crack. Then your width can be measured through the crack scale, and the depth can be measured through core test or through ultrasonic pulse velocity test. Then when you define, because the code itself says, has anybody referred IS 456 in the recent days, what is the crack width that is allowable? Can anyone say from the participants, my dear friends, please? Friends, can anyone say what is the crack width allowable crack width? Am I right? Code itself is allowing crack. Am I right or not? My dear friend?
Less than 0.2 mm.
Less than?
0.2 mm.
Is this Mr. Praveen Kumar?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Less than 0.2?
Sir, less than or equal to 0.2 mm, sir.
Is it mm or meter?
Mm, sir.
Are you sure?
Yes, sir.
Yes, confident.
Meter out, it will be too long, sir.
Huh?
2 mm, sir.
2 mm or 0.2
mm? Sorry, 0.2 mm. 0.2
mm. Okay. No, are you sure it is 2 mm or 0.2 mm? Are you confident enough?
0.2 mm, sir.
Is it true? Can we check, sir, with your sir, Vijay Vignesh, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sir, what your student are saying is correct?
So actually, depends on the type of exposure, sir. If it is extreme exposure, we can say 0.1 mm. If it is a severe or very severe exposure, we can say 0.2 mm. If it is a mild, moderate exposure, we can say 0.3 mm, sir. It is okay. Given in the code book, I think.
Yes. So, friends, why I have asked, he say, I have twisted you. I tried myself to twist you. In this way only the world will, when you come out, the world will twist you. You should be very confident of what you are saying. Okay. Okay, Mr. Praveen Kumar. Okay, friend. Hello.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
The world will twist you. Aray, how can you say 2 mm? Is it 2 mm? When we are attending a meeting, they will say, are you sure, Ravi Kumar, is it 2 mm? Then I should not be in a panic. Even the question, who is going to ask, who will be asking, maybe a general manager or you will be a head of something, even the board member, I should not get panic. Yes, sir, it is 2 mm. What's wrong? What is given in the imprinted in the code that we are saying? But if we are able to say, sir, as per class so and so of this code, this is what given, which you and me cannot change, you should be very confident. The world will try to twist you. You should be very confident in what you are saying. Okay. Finishing early frost damage, unsound materials, long-term drying shrinkage. Friends, I'll try to share one article on drying shrinkage. That will be very interesting for you to understand of what is drying shrinkage, what is the impact of it. Now, my dear friend, now we are going to non-destructive testing, NDT. Non-destructive. It is something how, when you go to a laboratory, how they are taking the blood from your body by putting a needle on your hand without stopping the blood flow. Am I right? Without disturbing the blood flow or without disturbing the function of the organs, they are taking the blood. The same way, by going to a non-destructive test, you are not going to destruct, or you are not going to disturb the function. You are not going to cause any damage. But at the same time, you are going to study the quality of the materials that are used for the structure. You are going to assess the quality through some test. It may be of field test and it may be of some lab test also. Lab test is conducted to understand the impact of chemicals, say chloride, sulfate, then even the core. If you want to understand the strength of the concrete, what is poured in the site, you have to go take core and you have to go to the lab and test it. Even if you want to understand the carbonation effect, because the concrete, the fresh concrete will be having a pH of 13. Since it is exposed towards the environmental effect, then because and to the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere keeps on attacking on the surface of the concrete, it will undergo carbonation. Carbonation means the effect deterioration due to carbon dioxide. Then that can also be determined. So, and even the corrosion of the steel inside without causing any damage to the reinforcement, we are going to assess whether your steel is in initial phase or in the intermediate phase or in the final
Students, please wait. There is a net issue there.
ஓகே ஜாயின் ஆயிட்டேனா ஓகே ஓகே எந்த ஸ்லைடுல இருந்து போயிட்டே ஓகே ஓகே ஒன் மினிட் சார் ஒன் செகண்ட் சார் தெரியுதா சார்
சார் யூ ஆர் டாக்கிங் அபவுட் NDT டெஸ்ட் சார் NDT டெஸ்ட் அந்த கார்பனேஷன்
எஸ் எஸ் ஓகே ஃப்ரெண்ட்ஸ் ஸோ தி கோட் வாட் எவர் ஐ ஆம் டிஸ்பிளேயிங் நவ் இன் தி சப்சிக்வெண்ட் த்ரீ ஸ்லைட்ஸ் will be are taken from IRC SP40 after the end of the session I will be sharing the copy of that code for you to under you kindly go through it okay. So the code defines the capability what are all the output that you can get and you in what way it helps you to understand or to assess because it is not required to do all tests. The repair and rehabilitation engineer, if you are going to inspect the site, you should decide what are the tests that are required to assess the strength parameter or what are the agencies that has made this type of deteriorations, whether it is due to chloride, it is due to sulfate, it is due to carbonation, or it is due to corrosion, or it is due to the porosity, the honeycombs, or it is due to the crack development, or it is because of the corrosion, everything. So according to the problem, that is why your site visit should be the first. In my last class, I have defined a flow chart. My dear friends, that flow chart will help you to understand how to assess the damage structure. Okay. Now I think in your laboratory you will be having a rebound test, am I right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Friends, are you aware that your laboratory is having the rebound hammer test? Hello. Hello.
Hi.
இல்ல இல்ல பசங்களுக்கு தெரியுமா சார்
I think they know, sir.
Hello, friends. Are you aware that your laboratory is having a rebound demo?
Okay. So it's a demo experiment, sir.
Correct. Demo, da. At the student level, all are demo only. When you go out and start practicing only, you can understand how it is going to help you in assessing the structures, strength. Friends, every test, see, if you go for ultrasonic pulse velocity, sir, it is having a capability good in cracking, assessing the crack. The output will help you to understand the crack effect. But it is not going to help you in scaling, understanding the scaling, corrosion, wear and abrasion, or even the strength. But it is having good capability in giving the output to understand the voids or the porosity. Whereas off-cell potential meter, it N means no, G means good, F means fair, P means poor, N means not suitable. So it is good in off-cell potential meter, is good in understanding of corrosion effect. See, in serial number 18, you have the rebound hammer test. It is good only in understanding the strength parameter, but whereas it is having its limitation in the terms of is not capable of cracking, scaling, corrosion, wear and abrasion voids. Okay, and even the carbonation test, it helps you to understand the corrosion, whereas other parameters not. So in the code book gives about nearly 24 tests. My dear friends, please, if you see the, hello? My dear friends, if you see serial number 20, the cover meter test, it doesn't have any capability, all are not capable. Then you can ask me a question, sir, then what is the purpose of the test? I will explain that with a photographic limb so that it will be very helpful for you. So now this is the table which I have taken from IS-456, table 7. What are the limitations of chloride content of concrete? If it is going to be an RCC with embedded steel or metal or PCC with embedded metal, then it is going to be 0.6 kg per cubic meter. Then if you're going to be precessed concrete, it's going to be 0.4 kg per cubic meter. So these are all the limitations. So therefore, when you are going to a site, you have to collect some samples of cover concrete powder. You have to chip off cover concrete powder, and that sample has to be taken into the lab, and you have to do the test. The detailed test procedures are given in the code. I will be sharing it to you after this class. So this, because when your structure is being constructed very close to the seashore, salinity area, then the chloride effect will play a vital role. The chloride will not have a great impact on the concrete, but it will have a great impact on the your structural steel, particularly caused by through causing corrosion. Now this table will give you what should be the minimum cement content and water cement ratio and a grade of concrete for different exposure condition: mild, moderate, severe, very severe, and extreme. This also table taken from IS 456. Please kindly take a look into those important tables. Now this photograph, this is the photograph view of the cover meter. My dear friends, cover meter, which is the art having a capability of understanding or giving the output of any parameter, but nevertheless this equipment is going to play a important role in understanding whether the cover, what you have mentioned in your good for construction drawing, may have a cover of 40 mm or 30 mm or 50 mm or 75 mm, whether the same is adapted in the site or not, how to identify it. You cannot every time check the concrete and measure the cover. That can be possible. So without disturbing the component, going to assess the cover. That's why it's called as cover meter or proscope. It also helps not identifying the cover. It also helps in identifying the bar spacing. 12 mm diameter, 1 mm center to center. But if you want to assess the same, whether it is being the 12 mm dia or 20 mm dia or 10 mm dia, that can also be assessed through this cover meter. The bar dia and the bar spacing, bar location, and the cover, everything can be mapped through this test. It is something like a scanning machine. So this will help you understand your the detailing part of marked in the drawing beyond the cover concrete. So sir, okay, what is the purpose by knowing all these parameters? Friends, when you are seeing some problem due to corrosion, a crack along the reinforcement length, as how we have seen in our first class, the photographic view of crack development along the rebar, or spalling of concrete has been taken place and showing the corrosion of steel. So this cover meter will help you to understand whether the cover is uniform all along the surface of the member. And also, suppose if you are planned to do some, to take some core, concrete core, then the concrete core, the drill machine cannot be fitted directly at every low at any place, and you can drill the machine and take the core. That cannot be done. The system should never work like that. First, you have to define the bar location, bar spacing, and without disturbing the rebars, without causing any damage to the rebars, you have to take the core. It is something like, I'm just for better understanding, it is something like If the doctor wants to, if there are some wound is there inside, they want to take some biopsy test, some scale is there, scaling is there, some doctor is having some doubt to identify what type of problem that is having, say in the lung, or in the stomach, abdomen inside. So they want to take some tissues. So what they will do, they will insert the needle inside and take the small tissues without causing any disturbance or damage to that organ as a whole. The same way here, without causing any disturbance or damage to the reinforcement or structural concrete, you are going to take the concrete core outside. So this cover meter will always help you to do that exercise. Friends, can we see some video to understand this? Vijay Kumar sir, can we see one video, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is often necessary to paste concrete structures after the concrete is hardened to determine whether the structure is suitable for its design. Ideally, such testing should be done.
Sir, audio is clear, no? That video's audio.
Sir, okay, sir.
Audio kekudhu illa, sir.
Konjam kammiya kekudhu, sir. But okay.
அப்ப நான் ஆடியோ வைக்கணுமா? ஒண்ணுதான்.
ஃபுல் ஆடியோ.
So dear friends, let's learn something.
Yes sir. Okay sir.
Called as a Smith indication of the concrete, which provide a convenient and rapid indication of the compressive strength of the concrete.
Friends, please see this video carefully. It will be helpful for you. This code IS133112 I will be sharing after the end of the session.
An objective of the concrete is to determine the compressive strength of the concrete by rating the rebound index and the compressive strength to assess the uniformity of the concrete, to assess the quality of the concrete based on the standard specifications, and to relate one concrete element with other in terms of the quality. Generally, rebound hammer test method can be used to differentiate the acceptable and questionable parts of the structure, or to compare two different structures based on its strength criteria. Now, if we talk about the operation of rebound hammer testing, then during testing, when the plunger of a rebound hammer is pressed against the surface of the concrete, a spring controlled mass with a constant energy is made to hit concrete surface to rebound back. The extent of rebound, which is a measure of the surface hardness, is measured on a graduated scale. This measured value is designated as rebound number or rebound index. A concrete with low strength and low stiffness will absorb more energy to yield in a lower rebound value. The compressive strength can be read directly from the graph provided on the body of the hammer. The impact energy required for the rebound hammer is different for different type of the applications. Like for normal weight concrete, it is about 2.25. For lightweight concrete, for small and impact resisting concrete part, it is 0.75, and for mass concrete testing, it is 30. There are certain points required to remember while performing the rebound hammer test. Number one is the concrete surface should be smooth, clean and dry. Number two is end loose particles should be removed off from the concrete surface with a grinding wheel or stone before hammering testing. Number three is rebound hammer test should not be conducted on rough surfaces as a result of incomplete compaction, loss of grout, sparred or torn concrete surface. The point of impact of rebound hammer on the concrete surface should be at least 20 mm away from the edge of the discontinuity. Number five is six readings of the rebound hammer is taken at each point testing, and an average of the value of that readings is taken as rebound index for the corresponding point of observation on concrete surface. The most suitable method of obtaining the correlation between compressive strength of concrete and rebound number is to test the concrete cubes using compression testing machine as well as using hammer test simultaneously. First, the rebound number of the concrete cube is taken, and then after, the compressive strength is tested on compression testing machine. After obtaining the correlation between compressive strength and rebound hammer number, the strength of structure can be assessed. In general, the number increases as the strength increases and is also affected by a number of parameters. Parameters like type of cement, type of aggregate, surface condition and moisture content of the concrete, curing and age of concrete, carbonation of concrete, etc. Moreover, the rebound index is indicative of compressive strength of concrete up to a limited depth from the surface. The internal cracks, flows or heterogeneity across the cross section will not be indicated by a rebound hammer. If we observe the quality of concrete for respective average rebound number, if number is more than 40, it is with a very good hard layer. Between 30 to 40, it is a good layer. 20 to 30, it is a fair concrete. And less than 20, it is known as poor concrete. If it is zero, then concrete is delaminated. As such, the estimation of strength of concrete by rebound hammer cannot be held to be very accurate. And probable accuracy of prediction of concrete strength in a structure is plus or minus 25%. If the relationship between rebound index and compressive strength can be found by test on core samples obtained from the structure or standard specimens made with the same concrete material and mixed proportion, then and then the accuracy of the results and confidence thereon gets greatly increased. The advantages of rebound hammer test are, number one is that apparatus is easy to use. Number two is determines uniformity property of the surface. Number three is the equipment is inexpensive. Number four is used for the rehabilitation of old monuments. Now, if we talk about disadvantages of rebound hammer test, then number one is the results obtained is based on a local point only. Number two is the test results are not directly related to the strength and the deformation property of the surface. Number three is the probe and spring arrangement will be required regular cleaning and maintenance. Number four is flows cannot be detected with accuracy. So dear friends, this is all about rebound hammer test of concrete.
So friends, so I hope this video will help you to understand the concept of why rebound hammer is being done and what are the advantages, disadvantages, and how to use it, how the values of rebound hammer has to be taken up, how it has to be compared with the compressive strength and everything. Now we'll move a little forward. There is another video with reference to NDT test also that you can see. Anyhow, my presentation will be shared to your professor and he will share to everybody. Now, my friends, the objective, the next test is UPV, ultrasonic pulse velocity. That is in short form, we call it as UPV. What is the objective? It is done to establish the homogeneity of the concrete, presence of cracks, voids, and other imperfections, changes in the structure of the concrete, which may occur with time, quality of concrete in relation to standard requirements, quality of one element of concrete in relation to another, and the values of dynamic elastomeric modulus of concrete. So this is a UPV test is something like passing your electro pulse pulses through the transducers. See, in this slide, you will be seeing this. There are two transducers. So this is one transducer, and this is another transducer. So it has electrical pulse generator, transducers one pair, then amplifier, and electronic timing device. My dear friends, so through this transducer, these electro pulses will be released. Through one will be transmitting this the electro pulses, and the another transducers will be at a receiving end. So the time taken for this electronic pulses on distances, this is the distance L, that will give the velocity. If the velocity is more, then the quality of congruity is also good. If the velocity is low, that will indicate the quality of congruity is not to the expectation as what is defined in your quality assurance manual or what is defined in the your good for construction drawing. So this ultrasonic pulse velocity test shall be conducted at site without disturbing the or without causing any damage to it. So to do that, so this in this slide a table is been also projected with above 4.5 velocity, the same formula, velocity equal to distance by 10 seconds, same formula is used here. So when the velocity is at 4.5 kilometer per second, then the condition of concrete is excellent. If it is ranging between 3.5 to 4.5, it is good. 3 to 3.5, it is medium. Below 3, it is poor. So that means more, when the velocity is keeps on in more and more, you are able to get a good quality of concrete which are confined in the respective structural member. Whereas when you get a low velocity value, that indicates that is the quality of concrete which are confined inside is not good, because it may be due to the velocity is very poor because due to cracks or honeycombs or porous inside, which you may not see through your naked eye. So this test can be conducted in three ways. One is direct, both the transmitter and the receiver are opposite to each other, whereas the second is semi-direct, and third one is indirect. So according to the site situation, the test can be conducted in any one of the way: direct, semi-direct, and indirect. But generally, direct will give more accurate results when compared to the semi-direct and indirect test. As I said, this test is also useful in understanding the depth of crack. So we will be seeing another video. Of UPV test.
Hello and welcome you all to this video. Myself Prashanthi, and
sir, audio is visible. Audible, sir?
Yes, sir. Audible. Sir.
In short form, we can call.
Okay.
It is also called as ultrasonic concrete tester. So before starting the demo, I will let you know what are the different parts of this machine. So this is a machine, and make is RTUL model 4600L. So you can see the backside of this machine, right? Now, RTUL provide two calibration block, one as per the IS516 revised standard. So one block is for calibration, other is for reference and for cross verification. So it is necessary as per NAVL, so or as per IS516. So there should be two calibration rod, one for calibration, other for cross verification. So this is your connecting cable. So two set of connecting cable and two transducer. So in this machine, this is one terminal and this is another terminal
and this is transmitter and this is a receiver. Okay, so this is on off switch and this is calibration knob. And in the back side, if you can see, this is the point where we can connect this cord. This is charging cord, mains cable. You can insert this here, and here this is at the another end. It is 2-pin. You can connect it with the socket. So that's how you can charge this machine. This machine is battery operated. Now I will show you the bag in which we can keep all these accessories. So this is machine. With a machine, you can keep all this thing in this bag. This transistor cable and mains block. This mains cable and
friends, I am trying to deliver the lecture through this type of videos for you to for an easy understanding.
So I will
suppose tomorrow when you go to the site as a project engineer or a site engineer, when you are being asked to do some ultrasonic pulse velocity, you should not be in a position to say to your project manager that I am not exposed to.
Now I have connected the cables with transducer, and now I'm connecting this cable with machine. So always make sure that when you are connecting this cable with machine, at that time your machine should be always in off condition. Never connect this cable with machine when machine is in on condition. Right now we have two transducer and cables. So which cable to be connected with which terminal? So there is no hard and fast rule. You can connect any of the cable with any of the terminal. So this is BNC cable. This is very simple to connect. You have to just match the slot and then you can connect it, right? So that's how. Here also you can connect it. Now connection is done, so we can switch on the machine. So before using this machine on actual concrete, we have to first calibrate this machine. So how to do the calibration? We have to use this smaller rod, and in this smaller rod we have known value of 40 microsecond. This machine will show you 40 microsecond. That means this machine.
So friends, before doing any test, you have to do the calibration.
40 microsecond.
Then only you have to start doing
any value less than that or higher than that. Then we have to rotate this calibration knob, and then by this rotating knob we can adjust the value. But we can see it is giving 40 microsecond reading. That means machine is okay. Now on the other rod we can see it is giving 65.0 microsecond, or sometime it is giving 65.1. So 65.1 it is giving, or 65.0 it is giving. So this machine has accuracy of 0.1 microsecond. So if it will give 65.1 or 64.9, that will be acceptable, because this machine has accuracy of 0.1 microsecond. Now I will see the reading on actual concrete. So we have to see demonstration in direct mode. So in direct mode, this is called direct mode when transistors are opposite to each other. So we can see reading 36.1 microsecond. So this 36.1 microsecond is time, and this is distance 150 mm. So we have to find velocity. Velocity is a formula, distance upon time. So 180 divided by 36.1, we will get value of velocity. So you have to always make sure that this value should be in mm, and this is in the microsecond. So when we will divide this mm by microsecond, you will get kilometer per second value, because
so what here is done is direct
microsecond is exactly equal to kilometer per second. So that's how we can calculate the value of velocity. So this is your direct mode. So now we will see semi-direct mode. In semi-direct mode, why semi-direct mode is required? When both the opposite face of the concrete is not accessible, at that time we use semi-direct mode. So this we can see semi-direct mode. In this mode, we put one transistor over on this surface and other on this surface. So now what will be your distance? Your distance will be this distance, this BC. And how to find this distance? We can use Pythagoras theorem. By that Pythagoras theorem, we can find this distance BC. And then we have formula, velocity is equal to distance upon time. So at place of distance, you can keep this value VC, and your time will be whatever time you will receive at this position. So that time will be divided by here. So we will get the velocity. Now indirect mode. Why indirect mode is used? When you have only one surface is accessible, like when you have to take reading on slabs, then you have only one surface accessible. So at that time, you can keep one transistor over here, other transistor over here,
and the distance will be your center to center distance of the probe. So this distance will be AB, so that AB will be your distance, and how to find the velocity, your formula, the same formula, and at the place of distance you can take your AB value in mm, and whatever you receive in machine, that time will be taken here, and by this formula you can get velocity. So this is your indirect mode. Once we get the velocity, so we can compare that velocity with the revised Indian standard, that is IS 516. Before it, we are comparing this velocity with the IS 13311 part 1, but now we can compare it with the IS 516. So as per IS 516, if your velocity lies between 3 to 3.75, your concrete will be doubtful, and below 3.0, put one transformer on this surface and other on this surface. So
friends, we will just keep moving on. So now the most important thing is, in the video you have seen that before doing the test, the surface is clean and they are applying some gel or grease over the concrete surface. Friends, you have to be very clear why, what is the importance of applying the grease or the gel. See, it is applied because to ensure the ultrasonic pulses generated at the transmitting transducer pass into concrete and are then detected by the receiving transducers. It is the gel or the grease is going to act like a membrane that will help to pass the pulses from the transmitter end into the concrete. So between the concrete surface and the transducers, it is going to act like a film that the generated electropulses will be taken into the concrete. So it is going to act like a membrane. So that is why, so because the process requires an adequate acoustical coupling between the concrete and face of each transducers. That is the purpose why every time the gel or grease is being applied over the concrete surface before the transducers are kept in position. Now friends, there is one more video which will help you to understand how this ultrasonic pulse velocity test is helping you to detect or determine the depth of crack. This is as per BS 1881 part 203. Friends, these videos will certainly, I personally feel, it will help at the student phase to understand how these tests are being carried out to the actual at site. So when you go to the site in the next 3 or 4 months, then you will be finding nothing new to you to operate this type of NDT equipments. So if somebody says how to measure, he raises a question at the site in your entry, how to measure the crack depth, you should immediately say that by using NDT ultrasonic pulse velocity test, I can determine the depth of the crack. Because depth of the crack is always in place important role to understand whether the crack has passed through the cover concrete or it is well within the cover concrete. So I am trying my best to show a video to the actually how they are measuring the in the presence of cracks, how they are physically measuring at site when they have observed a crack to see what is the depth. every time you see at 100 mm location as well as 200 mm location, they are applying the gel or grease, then only they are keeping the transducers. Okay. Now next is carbonation. As I explained, it is determining the effect of carbon dioxide. So this test, you have to apply a phenolphthalein indicator, which you might have used in your chemistry lab. The same indicator when you apply over the concrete. So this concrete directly you should not apply. You have to first chip off the top surface, then you have to apply the phenolphthalein indicator. So one option will be you will be getting color surface, pink color surface, or colorless. There will not be any change even after application of phenolphthalein indicator. So this magenta or pink color area represent that there is no carbonation effect or uncarbonated concrete. Whereas the remaining portion indicates the carbonated, that is the colorless area indicates the carbonation effect has taken place. Because this test will make us to understand how far the effect of carbonation is taken. Because when the carbonation of concrete is taken place, the pH value keeps on reducing. pH is like a immunity. The cover concrete is going to act like an external barrier in protecting the steel against the corrosion effect. So when the pH value is reduced, automatically you are opening the gate for the steel to undergo the process of corrosion. That is why this test will always, simple test will always help us to estimate how much depth of concrete has been undergone this carbonation effect. That is why sometimes when you go take the core to estimate the or determine the compressive strength, the same core can also be utilized to estimate the depth of carbonation effect. Next is half cell potential meter. This test is used to understand the corrosion effect, whether it is initial phase, transient phase, or final phase. It will give the current value in millivolts. So if it is less than minus 200, then it is in the end, there is no corrosion taking place. If it is in the range of minus 200 to minus 350, it is in the transient phase. Whereas when it is greater than minus 350 millivolts, then it is in the final phase of corrosion is already taking place. So to do this test, first the cover concrete has to be chipped so that the reinforcement is exposed, and with that exposed reinforcement, that this test will be conducted physically at the site. Now this slide will describe you about the various laboratory tests. The important test are compressive strength, that is core test, then sulfate test, chemical test, chloride test, and other different variety of tests are available. It depends upon the repair and rehabilitation engineer what are the other tests he requires to assess the damages. Accordingly, he can take a call. Now, this is the photographs. Will show you step by step of taking the core from the concrete member. First, you have to use this cover meter to estimate the location of bars, cover, and mark the location of where the drill bit has to be fixed for taking the core. Now, in the drill bit, you have to mark up to what depth you are planning to go take the core drill. The next, the drilling machine is fixed and it is operated. Then finally, you will be getting the core bit like this. Then it has to be taken out like a piece of cake. Particularly when you are doing a birthday cake cutting, how you are taking after cake cutting, how you are taking a small piece of cake without causing any damage to the original cake quantum. The same way the the core, the after do completing the core cutting activity, the sample has to be removed very cautiously. There should not be any damage to the drilled bit, that is the concrete bit. Now after removing it, you will be seeing inside whether any voids are there, whether it is clean, so you can see inside. Now after taking out, you can, if you are going, if you are, the core is taken perpendicular to the crack, you can measure what is the depth of the crack from the surface concrete. Then you can able to assess whether the depth of concrete is within the cover portion or it is beyond the cover portion. Then finally, after completing taking the core sample, then it has to be closed with the micro concreting or polymer cementitious mortar. You should not leave a void as it is. Now this is, the video shows how the drill bit works actually. Hold on, friends, please hold on. Just a moment. Sir, my screen is visible, sir?
No, sir. Not presenting, sir.
Okay, okay. One second. So in this way, the activity of drill bit will be physically happen at site. So in any way, in any manner, the reinforcement inside, the structural sheet inside should never get disturbed or it should not cut off. That is why you have been using in the first step itself the cover meter. Now suppose if your site condition doesn't permit you or you are finding difficult to take the core sample, then you have to go for CAFO test. So this test will be utilized to understand the compressive strength in similar fashion. So through this test also you can estimate the ultimate, what is the compressive strength of the concrete which is laid in the membrane. So here the triangular first term, the force required to pull out the triangular first term, that yellow color mark, that will estimate, or that it will give the relation directly to estimate the compressive strength. Okay, now this is capping.
Now, sometimes when you are going for an inspection, you cannot take every time the UPV test or other MDV test equipments to the site along with you. So, however, you should be in a comfortable position to estimate the soundness of the concrete where you are going for an inspection. Now, in that case, you have to take a hammer and you have to hit over the surface of the membrane, concrete, it may be of beam or a column or a slab or anything. If you are able to hear sound like, are you able to hear, sir?
Yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir.
What sound you are able to hear, sir?
Some metallic creaking.
Are you able to hear like a bell ring?
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
So if you are hearing that type of sound, then the concrete inside is free from pores, voids, cracks. If you are able to hear when you tap, like wooden sound, that means the concrete inside is suffering from voids, pores, cracks. Then the quality of concrete, even though you are having a very good finishing on the outer face, since it is already sick or suffering from this voids, pores, or honeycombs, cracks inside, certainly it will not meet your design compressive step. In that case, you have to completely remove all the concrete till you reach the sound concrete. Then you have to apply a bonding agent. The bonding agent will help you to fix with the parent concrete. Then you have to reapply with the micro concrete. Micro concrete is a ready mix concrete which will be coming in a 20 kg bag. Because when you are involved in the repair and rehabilitation, you cannot go for a RMC plant to get a 6 cubic meter cube of quantum of concrete for a design strength. That much quantum may not be required during repair and rehabilitation. So that is why whenever you are involved in R&R, this micro concreting will always helping us, because within 24 hours you will be reaching nearly 60 newton per meter. So that much compressive strength you can reach within a day. However, it is always advised to take a cubes samples and cure it for 7 days, 14, 28 days, then you do it the compressive strength and estimate what is the design strength that you are getting. Even though the manufacturer pamphlet defines the strength within 1 hour, 4 hours, 7 hours, 1 day, something like that. It is always advised, because those values are a laboratory condition. It is the responsibility of you who is going to act in the field of repair and rehabilitation to do the sample test. So finally, today, friends, we finally come to an end of this today's session. As I told, always since we are still not entirely come out of this pandemic period, so we have to follow all this protocols, health related activities. Please ensure we are always wear mask, and when you go out of your house, say always Vanakkam, Namaste, don't go for a handshaking, and wash your hands. Keep yourself more healthy, eat healthy foods. Keep yourself fit enough, physically fit enough, strong enough. Strong enough, fit enough is not related to muscular strength. It is related to your internal strength, how immune you are. So God bless everyone. Thanks for this opportunity given from yourself. Thank you, my dear friends. Any questions?
Thank you, sir. Students, if you have any questions, you can ask.
Yes. Friends, are you a little bit tired? Is my lecture is making you to understand all the concept? Friends, are you there?
Students?
Sachin, Sardar, Vijay, Vignesh, some more students. Are you clear? No more questions?
Yes, sir.
Yes, no more question. The answer is for no more question.
Sir, there is a question posted in the chat box, sir.
Oh.
Is NDT completely dependable other than other tests?
Richin John Charlie. Is NDT completely dependable than other tests? He is available now, sir? Mr. Richin?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Can you unmute yourself? Mr. Richin?
Richin?
Oh, yes, sir.
You are comfortable in English or Hindi or Tamil?
I'm good in English, sir.
Yeah, please tell me what is your question.
Sir, there may be situations where we cannot use like normal testing machines, like I mean testing like drilling or boring, and we depend on NDT. So can we depend on it completely and move ahead, or is it just an indicative test that the material has some problem, like the concrete has
which one, NDT? Yeah.
Oh yes, sir.
Sir, what your question is, please correct me in my understanding. Your question is whether if the site doesn't allow you to do the NDT test, like the core cutting or some like that, correct?
Yes, sir.
That is why we have a pull-out test, no? Which I have displayed a photographic of how the test will be done, and the force required to pull out that triangular thruster that will define the compressive strength of the sample. You have to drill a hole up to 25 mm, then you have to insert that equipment, and you have to pull that equipment. Then the force that is required to remove the triangular thruster that will define the compressive strength of the sample.
Okay, sir.
No, is you have any other understanding which I am not able to reach you?
No, sir, it's okay. Correct, sir.
Actually, NDT test is the test which has been done at site to add value to your assessment which you have carried out on the site. Some problem has happened, you have been asked to visit the site, you are visiting the site, you are mapping the problem, you are mapping the cracks, you are able to assess the actual background of the problem, the time duration of the problem has happened, or what is the total period of that problem, the distress is observed at the site, whether it is occurring repeatedly, even after any treatment is being carried out by the customer earlier, then the load configuration, everything or understanding, collection of data, then mapping of the problem, what you are visually seeing. Then this NDT test is a tool that is going to help you to assess the quality of the material that are being used in casting the beam in the slab or a column. So it may be of concrete, it may be of steel. Suppose you want to understand whether the cracks are because of corrosion or because of the load problem or because of the detailing issue, that's why you are using ultrasonic pulse velocity to understand what is the depth. Whether the crack pattern which you are seeing visually outside is within the cover concrete or it has passed beyond the cover concrete, because we are dealing with the bridges which are 70 years, 80 years old. But we have to deal with that bridges, we have to make the bridges to be physically fit enough to carry out its own self-weight as well as the live load. Because all our project corridors has to be fully functional at all time, meeting the safety. One is durability, another one is safety.
safety of the asset as well as safety of the vehicle users. All has to be ensured. I cannot say the bridge is almost 70-80 years old. Now you are giving to us. The client will be saying, when we are taking a project and we are going to operate it for 20 years, 30 years, already the baby's age may be 70, 75, 80 years. I cannot say to my client that the baby is already a very old age. Please send it to the old age home or demolish it. Then only I can able to maintain. No. It is the responsibility of the operator to ensure its durability, serviceability and safety. So first I have to understand whether any problem is there. At which component the problems are observed. I have to map everything. I have to get the as-built drawing correctly. And I have to understand for what load combination it has been designed. Because if we are in 2021, now the codes has been revised multiple times. More latest versions came by adding so many amendments, meeting the existing situations. So first of all, I have to map the problem, understand the load combination, understand the structural combinations. So our structural configuration can be understood only based on a clear study of the as-built drawing. Then understand what is the problem that I am visually seeing, then map it, convert it into the drawing format, map the problem, understand the source, the problem, understand the source, root causes. Understand the environmental where the structure is lying. Then, based upon this assessment, I can go for recommendation of some physical tests. So, to understand the quality of concrete, I can do ultrasonic pulse velocity. To understand whether the beam or a column or a slab is having a grade of concrete of 35 or 40 or 25, I can take a sample, then I can do at site. Because it has lived for 80 years, 50 years, 70 years. So I have to understand what are the effects due to environment. So I have to take some samples of the surface concrete sample. I have to test for sulfate content, chloride content. Then I have to understand the effect of carbon dioxide. Because for the 70 years, 80 years, it is exposed to the atmosphere. So I have to go for carbonation test, binocular indicator. I have to understand whether the carbon dioxide effect is within the cover or it is passed through the cover. And after doing assessing all this detailing, then I have to plan for the repairing. Whether I have to go only repair is required, or repair rehabilitation is required, or a combination of both repair and rehabilitation. Then I have to plan it, prepare the methodology, then select the suitable materials, then prepare the detailed working drawings, step-by-step procedure to be adopted at site, and then calculate the bill of quantities, then you go for improvements. Okay, my dear friends?
Okay, sir.
See, the doctor will assess the lab value as if and the symptoms what the patient is saying, he will correlate. Sometimes if you see the lab results, they will write, you have to correlate with the physical conditions. Correct? So therefore, you have to correlate your physical observation and the results. Sometimes the quality of concrete may be good. UPV may be giving good results. But at the site, you will be seeing some wooden sound. So immediately, that is why even when you are doing test, it has to be done very qualitatively. More experienced persons has to be involved in doing the physical test. Okay. You have to select the area of the concrete where you are going to do the test to assess the deterioration. So selection of area where the test has to be done is also plays an important role. And the more number of samples has to be taken. I cannot do a UPV test at only one location of a beam which is having a length of 10 meter and say the entire 10 meter is in good quality. No. I have to do at a frequent intervals. The average of all these things has to be assessed. Okay, my dear friend.
Okay, sir.
Any other question?
No, sir.
Okay. Friends, how about others?
I think there is no question, sir.
Okay. Yes, we can wind up, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sir, are you having any questions, sir?